We now have the pleasure of introducing this year's keynote speaker, Dr. Emalani Case.
Originally from Waimea on the Big Island of Hawaii, she grew up in a small town immersed in the stories of that place. Her lifelong training in hula or Hawaiian chant and dance taught her to see the world through the stories told.
These stories fueled her passion for writing and studying literature, eventually leading her to BA and MA degrees in English, and most recently to her PhD in Pacific Studies.
She developed a strong desire to speak Ōlelo Hawaii and to work with it, research it, write it, and even translate it.
Dr. Case will now continue to share her love of stories and histories in her new position as the Assistant Professor in Hawaiian Pacific Studies at the University of Hawaii, West Oahu.
As a Hawaiian woman, scholar, activist, writer, and dancer, she is deeply engaged in the issues of indigenous rights and representation, food, sovereignty, art and activism, and political independence and social justice.
Without further ado, we would like to welcome to the stage Dr. Emalani Case.
Aloha mai kākou. I feel like I'm looking at my classroom because my local students always sit in the back. Even though I tell them to come forward, they don't, and I think they think I'm scary, or they just want the more comfortable seats. I think those are the comfortable seats back there. I just wanted to say mahalo to everyone who put this together, and also a special mahalo to Ellen for contacting me and inviting me to be here. It's an honor to be here. And as I was walking down, I saw some of my past students. I saw some people I'm familiar with, so it's nice to see some friendly faces in the crowd. Before I get into what I prepared today, I just wanted to say something about what's called deep learning. A dear friend and mentor of mine actually passed away about 2 weeks ago, Teresia Tewa, and she was a warrior in terms of Pacific studies, and she was a phenomenal educator. And one of the things that she taught me is that when you become an educator, you have the responsibility to learn about learning. You have the responsibility to learn about teaching. Your education is just beginning when you decide to take on the role of becoming an educator. And so I really applaud all of you for being here and for just being open to discussing Hawaiian culture-based education and how it can be blended and integrated with 21st century skills and modern technologies, because I think that that shows your dedication not only to your haumana, but to you and to our future and to the future of Hawaii. So mahalo nui. Whenever I'm invited to speak, I like to tell stories. That's sort of how I share my mana'o. And I like to imagine that that's more of an indigenous way of speaking, sort of speaking through stories. You know, if you think about our kupuna, they didn't always speak so directly. Sometimes they speak in circles and you kind of have to pick up the meaning and the message from that. And so that's the way I like to share. Not that I'm gonna speak in circles, but well, I might, but I like to share stories, and hopefully in that you can get some little bits of information and some things to chew on and think about. Also, when I started to think about Hawaiian culture-based education and 21st century skills, I decided to sort of play with those ideas, so you might hear that today or this morning, and I like to pose challenges. That's sort of what I like to do as an educator. I'm always challenging my students, so I'm gonna maybe pose some challenges as well, and some things that you can perhaps think about as you go about your day and go to all of the different workshops and hear from all of the fabulous speakers who are going to speak today. So I'm gonna start with my tutu. This is my grandmother. You know, in Hawaii, we take our family everywhere, and I have to just say, there's a tiny baby in the front here, because we were without a babysitter this morning, so we had to bring my two-month-old nephew. So if he starts crying, I'm just gonna imagine he's cheering me on, and that's him in the corner. So Kalamai, he's eating right now, so we're hoping he'll stay quiet. So mahalo nui for this. This keynote was inspired by a conversation with my tutu, my maternal grandmother. Now, before I proceed, I should mention that I never met my tutu. She left the world before I came into it. Therefore, our interactions exist only in my dreams, in the memories that I've heard about her and in the imaginings that I've created with her, around her, and at her side. A few weeks ago, I sat at the place where her Ivi are buried and stared up at the Ko'olau Mountains and sent whispers into the wind for her. It was the first time in months that I had come to feel a sense of grounding, a sense of true belonging. You see, she was my connection to Aina, to place. Let me explain. I currently live on the island of Oahu, but I've always been grounded here on the Big Island. Thus, after relocating, I found myself somewhat adrift, not rootless or anchorless, but instead somewhat uncertain of the ground I was treading upon, feeling like a malihini or a stranger in a place not completely new to me, but also not completely known. So I went to visit Tutu. It was a late afternoon, and I could smell the rain approaching. I knew I only had a brief moment before I would be drenched, so I sat with her and I greeted her presence, deeply rooted in the land. And in that small moment, after reaching down and putting my hands to the earth, I looked up to see a landscape drastically changed. What were once unfamiliar mountains and streams became those that Tutu would have gazed upon, those that Tutu would have undoubtedly loved, those that would have sheltered her, taught her, and guided her when she had her children, and those that would have soothed her soul when she was in pain. In that brief and quiet moment, her world became my world. And when I stood up to leave, I knew that my ancestral connection to Oahu had been reawakened through her story, through her life, and through her memory in and of Aina. I could walk away feeling a bit more rooted, having been reminded that I never traversed this world alone. For as the great poet Maya Angelou once said, I go forth along and stand as 10,000 with every grandmother at my side. I share these reflections because for me, they tell a story of culture, experienced in moments carved out for connection. And as I hope to share in this keynote, these types of reflections provide this space for nurturing relationships, something that I believe is central to any culture-based education. My conversations with Tutu form the foundation of this address, one in which I will weave in and out of memory, story, analysis, and indigenous theory, one that will be rooted in Aina. Before I do so, however, I should note that Aina is not merely the land upon which we walk, dance, sing, and shout, or the land in which we plant. Aina is that which feeds. Yes, it is where our mea'ai, or our food, comes from, but on a much larger scale, it is also where all of our physical, spiritual, emotional, and cultural nourishment comes from. Thus, Aina can be land, however, it can also be sky, ocean, river, and mountain. It can also be heritage and culture. It can be any source that feeds. In the weeks prior to visiting Tutu, I had a craving for something from the Aina. I had an intense craving for ulu, or breadfruit. I knew that we were not quite into ulu season yet. However, something in me wanted it, and something in me needed it so bad that I visited every farmer's market I could think of, and I scanned between the branches of every breadfruit tree that I passed in Eva. I was even gonna go and knock on people's doors to request that when their ulu grew, if I could come and pay them for it. And then I thought, as a last resort, if I could even get processed ulu flour, which I haven't tried yet, because I couldn't find any, but if I could get some, that could finally satisfy this hunger. But after weeks of searching, I still turned up empty. Until one day, a dear friend gifted me a gorgeous, round, and perfectly plump ulu, just a few miles away from where my tutu is buried. So with my breadfruit in tow, I went to visit her and to sit at her side. And as I got there, I knew exactly where my cravings had come from. She had been trying to nourish me, my grandmother, whose name was Ululani. my own heavenly breadfruit. You see, the fruit was my way back to her. It was not the physical food that I needed, but rather the connection, the story, the relationship that it embodied. She wanted to connect me to Aina, I'm sure of it. Now, you may be thinking that this is a bit of a stretch, or that to link these experiences together is a far reach from anything practical, realistic, measurable, verifiable, or even common sense. That, I would argue, is precisely what a good Western education would tell me. And that, I would argue, is why Hawaiian culture-based education is essential. You see, I believe that our people understood themselves in relation, never in isolation. There was no separation between themselves and the land, themselves and the sky, themselves and the ocean. As one of my dearest friends, the late Teresia Tewa, once said, "We sweat and cry salt water, so we know that the ocean is really in our blood." Our people understood themselves as part of the natural world. Everything existed together because it had to. And any space between an entity and another was a space that connected. This is what Samoans and Tongans call the va, or the space between. Not a meaningless or empty space, but a space of potential, one of purpose. It is a space to be nurtured, a space of relationships. Each one of us in this room, for example, is connected. Perhaps not physically or even ancestrally, but we are here, each contributing to the energy of this space. We are here, each bound by what we are hearing and seeing and learning and tasting. We are here, each bound by the potential to form relationships with people, with place, with knowledge, and with story. And we are here, each connected by our dedication to wa'o, which is the reciprocal process of teaching and learning that must inspire our students. Therefore, in an attempt to feed that potential, or that space between each one of us in this room, between the content we will explore, the lessons we will teach each other, and the stories that we will share, I will offer some thoughts as a point of connection, something that we can think about and chew on as we get a taste of what Hawaiian culture-based education can mean for us today. Of course, any attempt to do so must start with culture. Culture, as Samoan novelist and poet Albert Wendt argues, is not fixed. It is not stagnant. Culture cannot be pinned down or captured. It cannot be frozen behind a glass in a museum. Culture, he proposes, is as fluid and fixed as the ocean that we come from, the ocean that we call home. In fact, the only valid culture worth having, he argues, is the one being lived out now, the one moving with the current rise and fall of the tides. Now, his words have certainly caused a stir, and they've been met with some criticism, particularly among those romantics of culture or those who are caught up in notions of authenticity and tradition. Whatever the reaction, however, it's hard to ignore the fact that his words have power. His words make us creators of culture. His words make us those with the agency to make choices each and every day about how we will live our lives, dedicated to our people, to our customs, and to our indigenous knowledge. His words give us the mana to choose every single second to be indigenous and to act upon that indigeneity. We build on the past, on our values, on our core beliefs, and on our practices, and we create culture so that we can extend the lives of our ancestors and our people into the future, ensuring that our children and our grandchildren can survive as Hawaiians in a contemporary world. We build on the past and create culture to ensure that they will always have that same opportunity or that same space to shape culture for themselves, a culture based firmly in the past, but one that meets the needs of today. We build on the past and create culture, becoming the grandmothers and grandfathers, I won't leave you out, who will stand alongside our descendants by the thousands, even if or when they don't know we're there. Why? So that we can help them to satisfy that craving for ancestral belonging when it comes. And it will come. It will come. Because our children and our students live in a world that continues to try to distance them from who they are, that continues to try to distance them from Aina, from that which feeds, and that continues to try to distance them from a true sense of nourishment and satisfaction rooted and cultivated in place. When I took my ulu home after having visited with Tutu, I could not wait to cook it, to be fed by it. So I used the element of heat, as people around the world have done for centuries, making it more digestible for my body, making it soft enough for my soul. In the process, I employed adaptations of ancient technologies, as cooking in itself is an ancient process. Where families would have once gathered around a hearth or around a pit of heat and fire, however, I used modern tools to prepare my ulu, all the while remembering where it came from and who it came from, both the friend who gifted it to me and the craving that drove me to my grandmother. And as the smell of breadfruit filled my tiny house, my mind drifted to ulu-scented memories of people and places that I remembered fondly. The breadfruit my father used to make and salivate over, the breadfruit I was given as a gift by one of my most influential teachers when I graduated, the breadfruit I ate in the Marquesas and that reminded me of home and made me savor ancestral connections across our sea of islands, and the breadfruit I was overjoyed to find cradled in my friend's hands before she smiled and silently placed it into my own. And then I remembered that for our ancestors, food was ceremony and consumption was ritual. And I wondered, do we still nourish ourselves in this way? Before her recent passing, a close friend and mentor of mine shared a poem with me. It came from a day where she was supposed to go to church, but didn't. It was Easter Sunday. As she sat pondering her decision, her mind wandered to food rituals that are bound to religious practice. We eat wheat bread and drink grape wine, symbolic of the body and blood of Christ. But why, she wondered, must our Savior always be imported, flown in, or shipped in from faraway lands? Why must God always be colonizer, tourist, or cargo? I chewed on her poetic musings for a while and realized that we had our own ways of eating that connected us to our divine entities, that connected us to place and people, that connected us to all of creation and to each other. Therefore, as I ate my ulu, I remembered my grandmother and I remembered stories of sacrifice. An old mo'olelo tells us of the god Ku and his life as a planter on this island. Although quite skilled in cultivating and growing food, his people were once stricken by a famine that left them starving and hopeless. Seeing their pain and anguish, he told his wife that there was a way that he could help them, but that he would have to leave them in order to do so. Looking at her children slumped over in weakness, she consented and offered Ku her last goodbye. With his family close, Ku stood as his name instructed, Ku, erect, Ku, strong, Ku, firmly planted in the land. And as they watched in sorrow, he began to sink into the earth until he was completely buried in it, surrounded by Aina. With heavy tears, the people cried over this patch of earth, and in the early morning, they noticed a shifting, a movement, a stir in the ground. What began as a tiny sprout of green grew into a wondrous tree branching out towards the sky with thick, dark leaves and with perfectly plump ulu. Looking upon this figure, Ku's wife understood that her husband had become the tree, the trunk, his body, the branches, his limbs, the leaves, his hands, and the fruit, his head. Each ulu containing the memory of his life, his sacrifice, and his love for his people. When I ate the ulu, I remembered this. I remembered that our ancestors considered food their relatives, their greatest teachers, their communion with gods. Thus, true nourishment was not about satisfying physical hunger. All humans on the planet are bound and linked by the biological need to eat. But for us, for Kanaka Maoli, true nourishment came from realizing the relationship between food and body, between ancestor and descendant, between place and people. Thus, it's no wonder that one of the first strikes of colonialism, one of the first acts of war against an indigenous people, is to cut them off from their food and from their resources, so that they are not only stripped of the ability to feed themselves physically, but are simultaneously stripped of the ability to nourish themselves spiritually, emotionally, and culturally. They are stripped of connection, and in doing so, from an entire way of being and seeing the world. And we need not look far into the past to see examples of this. Think of pipelines. Think of telescopes. Think of oil drilling. Think of dredging. Think of bombing. Think of the pillaging of land and the erasure of history for profit. Examples of forced disconnection are everywhere, and examples of lived disconnection are even more abundant, so abundant that we sometimes can't see them. Therefore, as I ate, and as I considered these seemingly disconnected ideas together, filling the va, or the space between memory and food, between story and ancestry, between ritual and consumption, I wondered, is it possible to eat this way again? Is it possible to feed ourselves with foods that come from the lands of our birth, from the lands of our ancestors, foods that link us to who we were, who we are, and who we can be, foods that take us back to our grandmothers? Now, with such a lengthy introduction, you may be asking yourself what this has to do with Hawaiian culture-based education, and it is precisely this. Education, in the traditional sense, fills. You'll be full. Hawaiian culture-based education, on the other hand, must nourish. It must go beyond the filling. As a teacher, I often wonder what I'm feeding my students. When I walk into the classroom, am I going to supply them with the things that I've picked up off of a shelf, like the shiny and perfectly packaged foods labeled healthy and nutrient-packed, when in reality they are overly processed and probably devoid of any true substance? Or am I going to go an even easier route and feed them the pre-designed, pre-determined, and pre-made meal, one that can be consumed anywhere in the world and still taste the same? Or am I going to give them the knowledge, the resources, and the technologies, both old and new, that they can use to one day sustain themselves? Now, I believe that the metaphor of food actually translates quite well into the classroom. Why? Because we live in an era of McDonaldization. That's a thing. There's books been written about it. And although we may not want to admit it, even our education systems are in danger of being McDonaldized. Think about it. McDonald's runs on certain core values: predictability, reliability, and convenience. Wherever you are in the world, you can walk into one of these restaurants and know that they will have certain key items on the menu, thus making them predictable. These items will not only taste the same, but will also feed your increasingly homogenized palate, a product of globalization, no doubt, thus making them reliable. And these items will be convenient, supposedly saving you time while also conveniently distancing you from aina, from connection, and from a sense of identity and urgency to maintain your food ways and your life ways. And as we've been feasting on fast foods to accommodate our fast lives, societies have adopted these same principles to the point where they can be seen everywhere. In fact, the very ubiquity of these principles makes them almost invisible to us today. If you consider it, you can see that we are constantly being exposed and bombarded by quick fixes and time savers, anything and everything to make our lives more efficient. Even our banks and our pharmacies have adapted so that you don't even have to get out of your car to get what you need, because medication and money come straight to you. That's if you have money in the bank, of course. Sometimes it doesn't work for some of us. But the more that our lives are introduced to efficiency through machines and advanced technologies, the more we are living the impacts of disconnection, sometimes even without being aware of it. In fact, it's even in the way we educate our children. I would argue that standardization is the McDonaldization of education. That's a lot of shun. It's the assumption that you can serve students the same curriculum, presenting it on the same trays, with the exact same components, regardless of location, or perhaps more precisely, while ignoring location altogether. It is the assumption that you can walk into any school in the country and students of the same age will be receiving the same content, passing the same tests, and achieving at the same levels as students at any other school. And it is the assumption that these classrooms will produce students with similar knowledge, making it easier to assess them, easier to predict their outcomes, and easier to rely on so-called proven methods that, although suited for some, are never suited for all. Hawaiian culture-based education is the antidote to this. It is the foundation of relationship and connection that our students need. Yet in today's society, we are presented with a challenge. With all of the advancements that make our lives faster and apparently more efficient, our children and our students seem to have less and less space and less time to slow down and savor the richness of their heritage. I increasingly hear phrases in my own classroom like, "I'm Hawaiian, but I didn't grow up that way," or "I don't really know my history," or "I have a Hawaiian name and I think it means, but I'm not sure. And I'm not really even sure how to say it. Can you help me?" While I'm also honored to have many young Kanaka Maoli students who are steadfast and solid in who they are, my classrooms seem to be filled with more and more examples of the former. Those who are starving for a sense of identity, not quite knowing where and how to feed that ancestral craving for connection. This has made me realize that while our students are advantaged with every technology imaginable, some of them are simultaneously disadvantaged because they've lost the ability, and perhaps even worse, the opportunity to connect without these technologies. Thus, I believe that a 21st century skill to cultivate and grow is one of relationship. One of teaching students how to see themselves as not only part of the aina, but also part of an ongoing genealogy of people, places, and events that they can add to, or perhaps more precisely, that they must add to. The students of today will be far more literate in modern technologies than we will ever be. Since I started teaching in 2007, I've noticed a drastic change in my classrooms. The students of today are those who have never known a life without swiping left, without Googling, without the wonders of the internet. They are used to having the world at their fingertips, literally. They can go anywhere and be anything virtually in a matter of seconds. Thanks to technology, the world is becoming smaller and smaller as humans are more and more connected, and sometimes, to my own dismay, more and more the same. The students of today seek instant gratification, instant approval, instant confirmation of worthiness and importance in a like on Facebook, a heart on Instagram, or a comment solidifying their existence. The students of today, in fact, are so connected to everything and everyone that they are at the same time disconnected. Connected to the world, disconnected to aina. So my question is, What are the 21st century skills that you are going to cultivate? And how will these skills empower our youth to live understanding themselves as indigenous, as part of the land, as feeding from their ancestors, as standing always with 10,000 at their side? What opportunities will you afford them in and out of the classroom and together? How can we mentor them and not necessarily teach culture, but provide spaces for living culture? I believe the potential of Hawaiian culture-based education is as wide and vast as our ocean. To be culture-based is not to bring tokens of culture into the classroom or small tidbits of knowledge or relics from a deserted past. It is not to centralize the imported, the shipped in, or the flown in concepts or Hawaiianize the foreign. Rather, it is to tap into the ways of knowing and being that our kupuna lived by, and to teach and learn in that fashion, respecting the plina, or the bond between all things. Post-colonial scholar Ningugi wa Thiong'o once wrote about what he calls the cultural bomb. The effect of a cultural bomb, he said, is to annihilate a people's belief in their names, in their languages, in their environment, in their heritage of struggle, in their unity, in their capacities, and ultimately in themselves. I see the lingering impacts of this in our communities, in our families, in the things we say to ourselves about ourselves, in the things that our students say to themselves about themselves and their potential. Culture runs the risk of becoming a required subject, a portioned out time of the day, spoon-fed to them. Culture, however, must frame their day. It must be so ubiquitous that they're almost unaware of it. Culture must simply be the way things are. It must be part of every day, starting from how they meet and greet each other, to how they are welcomed into a shared space of learning, to how they become co-carriers of responsibility with the ability to respond to the challenges of today. They must be immersed in aloha while also being primed to be cultivators of it, ready the soil for an empowered future. Our children and our students must never be complacent, must never forget the past, must never be without connection. Our classrooms can provide the space to taste the realities of what it means to be a contemporary Hawaiian today and what it takes to carry a nation forward. I think about my tutu often these days and wonder how she would have taught me, how she would have nourished me, and how she would have showed me the wonders of the world. Although we never had that chance, I imagine that it would have started with aina, and that it would have included really good food, nourishing, healthy, from the soil and sea. I imagine that it would have involved storytelling and ancestral memories, working and sweating, feeling the weight of our pasts, the beauty and the pain. I imagine that it would have included sitting with her without a screen or an app between us. Instead, I imagine that we would have filled that space, that va, with story, creating memory and creating culture. Now, I'm not saying that technology is a hindrance to deep learning or to a type of learning that goes beyond the feeding of facts and the regurgitation of information. What I am saying is that technology must be a tool, not the tool. It must be a tool for tapping into the breadth and depth of our ancestral knowledge. In short, it must be a tool used to cook the ulu, as it cannot and should never be the meat or the substance to be consumed. Can't live off of that. It must be used to make knowledge more digestible and softer for our contemporary palates, but must never be the sole source of nourishment itself. Culture must be what feeds. Aina must be what feeds. History and ancestry must be what feeds. And modern technologies can be the spoon for that, but not the meal. It must lead us to new tastes, new smells, new experiences of connection. A couple of days ago, I took a walk with my father and my older sister. And as we hiked forest trails in mud-soaked boots, embraced by mist and the scent of dancing olapa, my dad recounted his time eating hapu'u shoots. He had recently taught my sister how to prepare them, and as he spoke, he reminisced, telling me about these fern shoots brought back memories of place and people, so many, in fact, that he could have traced an entire mo'oku auhau or genealogy through food. When I thought about hapu'u, I was reminded that these shoots were once a famine food, something that people would only eat if they had nothing else. It was a survival food, but for my dad, when he spoke about them, it was with fondness. And when my sister recounted the process of learning how to make them the week before, it was with pride. They had gathered the shoots together in the forest above our home. My father had instructed her on how to choose the right ones. They then boiled them so that they could peel them and soak them, all in preparation for the final cooking. And when they ate them days later, it was a solidification of their relationship, a confirmation of ancestral knowledge, and a validation of connection to Aina. They had been fed and nourished by the experience, and they were still salivating over it. As I listened to their memories unfold, I realized that our children need these types of experiences. Why? Because they're starving for them. And they're in danger of being malnourished, perhaps not physically, but spiritually and culturally. Thus, they need these so-called famine foods so that their taste buds can readjust and rejoice and begin to hunger for more. They need foods for survival because our survival as a nation depends on it. Our students need a true taste of what it means to be Aloha Aina. Aloha Aina is far more than loving the land. As many contemporary Hawaiian scholars would agree, it is about a constant and loyal dedication to the life of our nation. It is a never-ending fight for the betterment of our people. This commitment, I believe, comes through knowing the land, the ocean, and all of our sources of sustenance intimately, knowing them as ancestors, treating them as ancestors, seeing them as the grandmothers who march at our sides by the thousands. The future of our people will reside in the ability of our youth to see beyond the screen in front of them, beyond the glow of their social media outlets, their instant likes, and their constant updates, so that they can slow down and savor the depth and richness of everything around them, so that they can put hands to Aina and feel its pulse. Our children and students need the skill and the strength to awamokuleana, or to carry their responsibilities, to serve and feed their people, to strengthen ancestral connections, and to use them as a base for protecting and safeguarding all of those sources that feed. To awamo is to put a pole across your back, one used to carry large bundles of food, water, or supplies, and to shoulder that burden for the next generation. Thus, our students must be reawakened and reawakened constantly to the beauty, the power, and the pain of being Indigenous. What is responsibility but the ability to respond? And in today's world, where our children can access anything and everything at the push of a button, they will need guidance in becoming stewards of what's beneath their feet. They will need guidance in learning how and when to respond to today's challenges, and that can only come through connection, through pockets and moments and silences for feeding and tasting kuleana. Without this, we will be lost. Thus, the 21st century skill that I hope to cultivate in my classrooms is one of connection. Everything that I teach is in relation to my students. They are always pushed to find that personal relevance, or that string of action and thought that can make anything, even the seemingly foreign, somehow personal, or something with the potential to impact them in the way they see the world. Any and all modern technologies used are used to support this mission and never to distract from it. Why? Because our youth have enough distractions, and what they need now is hope. We need to grow hope from the soil. We need to harvest it from the sea. We need to pull it from the clouds. We need to be washed in it. but we will not see it or grasp it or be nourished by such hope until we are able to cultivate it, starting in our classrooms. Hope in itself is a radical political act, one that defies any and all attempts to silence us, to marginalize us, or to even bomb us out of existence. It is a political act in a world that expects us to lose hope, to dream smaller, and to give up and assimilate. Thus, we must build hope and a sense of pride, and this must come from a willingness and a dedication to stand for something bigger than oneself. I firmly believe that our students will only know what that something bigger is when they can look up from the screen momentarily, or turn off the music in their headphones, or distance themselves from the keyboard and close their eyes, putting ear to the breeze, putting hand to the earth, putting heart to the knowledge of who they were, who they are, and who they can certainly become. So give your students this chance through a culture-based education that nourishes, that feeds them experiences and moments for change, moments for connection, moments for communion with their grandmothers. Give them the chance to fill the spaces between with meaning and purpose. Feed them, nourish them, and let them sigh audibly. Mahalo.